And now, a moment from the OCCULTURE archives. Episode 68, Eric Davis, Miguel Connor, and Jeff Wolf in Babylon Rising.
Apparently there was a particular area of the Mojave Desert where two power lines crossed, and Parsons found this to be a real powerful spot where he would do some of his outdoor rituals. Itself, again, one of these symbols, again, like something you'd read in a fiction, where the novelist was trying to say, wow, you know, here's this guy, he's like bridging the archaic pre-modern world of magical practice with the modern world of rocketry and transmission lines and electromagnetism. So, oh yeah, I'll have him do this at the crossing of two transmission lines in the Mojave Desert, which people still aren't sure where it is. There's debate. People have tried to find out where this spot was, but it's just beautiful because it's even more beautiful because it's true.
Yo, from the Kingdom of Ohio, you are listening to OCCULTURE, where hardships will always and forever lead us to the stars. I am your host, Ryan Peverly. Welcome to the show. Thanks for hanging. And what a privilege it is to place the letters on the marquee for this one. And those letters spell out the name of George Pendle. George is the author of the book Strange Angel, The Otherworldly Life of John Whiteside Parsons, which, if you haven't heard, has been adapted to series for CBS All-Access, and it's airing there right now as you hear this. I think there's 4 episodes out, and George is going to make his way into the house for the first time to talk a bit about what it was like to research and write about Jack Parsons, some of the atmosphere and aesthetic around him that shaped who he became, and his thoughts on Jack Parsons going mainstream via his television series. So let's do the damn thing already and cast this pod off deep into the heart of Southern California in the early 20th century, where clairvoyants, palm readers, Hindu frauds, crazy cults, fake healers, and Chinese doctors all plied their trade, where rocket science magically transformed from fiction to reality, and where death by explosion actually seems kind of mundane, all things considered. Enjoy. Pencil. All right, so, George Pendle, thank you so much for being here, man.
No, it's my pleasure.
Oh, no. Believe me, the pleasure is mine. It's really great to have you here. I'm a big fan of your Strange Angel book and the Parsons story in general. It's the first of 2 Parsons biographies that I've read in my life. And you know, it's a really exciting time for you and for, I guess, people who are fans of this story. The TV show based on your book has debuted recently on CBS All Access. It was about a week ago from when we're talking now. And we'll get to the visual treatment a bit later. But I wanted to start at the beginning of your story and the first time that you came across the name John Whiteside Parsons. The book was published in 2005, but when was it exactly that you first ventured into the world of sex, magic, and rocket science?
Yeah, well, it was around 2002. I'm a journalist by profession, and I was writing for an art magazine called Freeze at the time. They had commissioned me to do a piece on Kenneth Anger, who you may know as being a kind of avant-garde filmmaker from the 50s and 60s with very deep occult kind of themes. And I was told by my editor that, you know, you should look into this one actress who's in one of his films. She's called Marjorie Cameron. Just check out, she had a weird husband. I don't know quite what the story is, but, you know, look into it. And so I looked into it, and, you know, there wasn't much written about Marjorie Cameron or indeed about her husband, but it was basically in a footnote in a film criticism book, which basically says Marjorie Cameron was married to the eccentric rocket scientist occultist Jack Parsons. You know, and I was like, what? That's it? There's nothing more? And so, you know, I naturally kind of looked into it, and I found he'd been mentioned, you know, in a few other places. He'd been mentioned in Mike Davis's kind of history of Los Angeles as a kind of utopia and dystopia. It's a book called City of Quartz. It's a great read. And he's there mentioned, you know, there's about half a page kind of that mentions Jack Parsons. And so I started looking around and I started digging into it. Eventually down the road, I discovered that there had been this book, Sex and Rockets, which had come out a few years before by the pseudonymous, is that right? Jack Carter.
Yeah.
It was by Ferrell House. But to begin with, I didn't have anything. This is, you know, 2002. Things weren't as easy to find on the internet as they are now. It's very hard to remember that, but they just weren't. And so I just kept on looking. I thought, well, if he was a rocket scientist, let's look at some science books. And there was really nothing about him. He was this creature who lived in footnotes and in hearsay. And he was like, you know, that was it. And so my idea was, well, you know, I wrote the article about Kenneth Anger. I found what I could about Jack Parsons. But I thought, let's try and dig into it and let's try and find out, you know, there's a lot of hearsay. There's a lot of smoke. Let's try and find the fire beneath the smoke, you know. And that was really it. And from about 2002 till when the book came out in 2005, it was devoted to trying to dig out every single bit of verifiable information about Parsons that I could from like every corner of the world, whether it be science, the occult, science fiction, whatever. And that was really the beginnings of it.
Yeah. So what was your first impression of Jack Parsons as a character? And then how did your opinion or your view of him change as you got further into the research and the writing?
Yeah. I mean, to begin with, I think everybody who first hears about him is like, you're kidding. You know, this is a ridiculous character. He didn't exist. This must be, you know, overblown in some way. So I went in really kind of expecting to find somebody a lot smaller than the myths that had grown up around him. And, you know, what was surprising was, you know, the myths didn't really capture half of it. The myths were actually a detriment to the real Parsons story. You know, I think he is one of the few times when you can really say fact is stranger than fiction, because just the stuff he did, the stuff he wrote, the stuff he thought, the worlds he kind of meshed together are implausible. And really a lot of the kind of stuff which came bubbling up distracted from that. So really, you know, I went in expecting to kind of find out, you know, find him to be a lot simpler than he actually was. And what I ended up finding was this really complex guy who, you know, I ended up, you know, terribly admiring. I admired the fact that he kind of stuck to his guns in the way he did in rocketry and occultism and in science fiction and everything. I mean, ultimately to his, you know, to his kind of bitter end. But that was really it. I was really, the more I dug into his story, the more I was like, oh wow, this guy really was an incredibly fascinating guy. I was never disappointed by anything he did, really.
Yeah, you know, so it's funny that you opened the book too with the scene of his death, which I thought was fantastic. It's just this sort of controversial, maybe even conspiratorial end to his life. And it would absolutely, like, if somebody picked up the book as a Parsons novice, it would absolutely intrigue them, you know, from those opening pages. And it really acts as a great preface for the rest of the story, as odd as that may sound, since you're starting at the end of it. But there's a minor detail here, a simple description in this opening chapter that characterizes, I think, the entire Parsons narrative. You were talking about his death, obviously, and the mystery and the intrigue that surrounded it in the days and weeks after. And it's important to note, too, that his mom died only hours after he did, to further add to that intrigue. But you said that it went from a family tragedy and a scientific calamity to a gothic horror story with a dash of film noir. And, George, I have to tell you, man, like, I got a bit probably too excited by that turn of phrase. I love it. I love the characterization of it. I love the images and the tone and the aesthetic that it invokes. And as a guy who's read those types of stories and watched those types of films, looking at the story of Jack Parsons through that particular lens is completely appropriate. But it does beg a question. When you were researching Jack's life here, how many times did you step back and have to question the authenticity of it? Because it strikes most people as fiction. And it reads like one of those great genre-bending novels.
Yeah, no, it's true. It's kind of pinching before pinching, you know. I mean, the thing was, you know, the way I described it there, that was very much how his death was perceived, you know, by the newspapers at the time, by his friends, you know, by the hearsay that was going around. And the idea was to show this kind of, you know, this kind of myth that had built up around him, never more strongly than at his death. And then to try and kind of cut through that and find out where it all comes from. And so, you know, what I had to do, and, you know, there were a lot of dead ends that I went down. I'd heard a story about this and I'd try and find out where it came from and just find it was unverifiable, you know. But the thing was just to, like I said, I trained as a journalist. And so the thing was just to try and treat it as a, you know, as a respectable news story, you know, or a feature story. How would a normal journalist do this? And they'd go for the primary sources, they'd go for witnesses, friends, you know, they'd go for anything which had his touch on it or somebody who was only one step removed from him. So that's really what I did. And I kind of treated it. I thought I'm going to be as objective as possible. Like you said, it's difficult, but I'm going to be as objective to a fault. When I look back at the book now, I kind of think, oh, maybe you were a bit too harsh. You know, maybe you should have kind of gone down a few more avenues and kind of hypothesized about what may have happened. But I tried to be as rigorous as I could be at the time and not really say anything that I couldn't prove with a source. And so that's what I did. And you know, it turns out that when I wrote the book, when I was researching the book, there was still, you know, a handful of people who knew him, and, you know, not least his first wife, Helen Parsons Smith. And so I got to speak to her. I got to speak to various people, put me in touch with other people. And I kind of went down a kind of whole, you know, investigative route into his life. But, you know, I always had to catch myself because I always had to think, is this real? Is this not? Is this just something that, you know, the myths build up over time, they're kind of accretory. And I think I had to make sure that even the people who I was speaking to weren't just kind of saying some myth that was stuck in their minds. So it just took a lot of, you know, cross-referencing and interrogating. And that was really it. Everything I put in the book, I think, was absolutely verifiable. Took some time, but I think it's as close as I could get to the truth.
Well, you mentioned Sex and Rockets a few minutes ago. Did you ever reach out to Farrell House or try to track down this pseudonymous John Carter and pick their brains about this?
You know, I did. I only found out about Sex and Rockets about, well, I don't know, quite a few months into research. And then I wrote to the publisher of Farrell House, Adam Parfrey, who sadly just passed away recently. So I really liked Farrell House's previous books. I did a book called Apocalypse Culture, I think, which was kind of the internet before the internet came about. I think it's been described as, it was a great book of occult lore and weird stories and UFOs and all sorts of fun stuff. And I wrote to Adam Parfrey and said, look, I saw your book. I'd like to do a more kind of hardcore biography, so to speak, than Sex and Rockets was. I'd like to really, you know, go out and pin down the facts. And I never heard anything back. And still, you know, a few years afterwards, I never heard anything from him. I wrote again, I think, after the book was published, and just, I think I might have even sent him a copy of the book and just said, look, here it is, you know, for what it's worth. But I don't think he was very pleased that I was stepping on, I think, what he considered his turf. So,
yeah. Well, since you started with his death in the book, let's just stay with that for a moment. You know, what sure. Do you think? Was this a lab accident? Was there some foul play involved? Was it some elaborate suicide? I mean, if you had to really put your money on something here, what happened?
Yeah, well, I mean, you know, in his end is really, that's where I really wanted to kind of try and come up with, you know, try and find the truth as closely as I could. Ultimately, it's impossible because Parsons was the only person in his laboratory at the time. We think. But in his death, you know, you had all these different parts of his life being used as explanations for his death. So, you know, the occult friends of his from the OTO thought he was summoning some kind of homunculus. You know, the science fiction friends thought he was creating some new kind of rocket fuel, which would be even better for, you know, sending rockets into space. You know, his friends who knew about his work, kind of getting corrupt cops thrown in jail, thought it was a car bomb, that, you know, some kind of bomb which had killed him. So the idea was to show that all these different strands each had their own myth attached to him, and then try and hack it back and find out what was most plausible. And although assassination, you know, is in LA at that time, it was not unthinkable. And although he was definitely involved in some very peculiar magic rituals, you know, very far out magic rituals, even compared to most, you know, magicians at the time, what he was doing was really out there on a limb. I ultimately kind of went by kind of Occam's razor and thought, okay, try and go for the simplest idea, the simplest solution is possibly the best. And his closest friend, Ed Foreman, who was one of the rocketry suicide squad that he was part of, said, you know, it was probably just that Jack sweated a lot when he worked, and he was doing a rush order for some explosives. And he just thinks that the, you know, the kind of beaker he was using to mix his explosives slipped out of his hand. And that ultimately is what killed him. So ultimately, I go, although I can't be 100% sure, I lean towards accident. But there are many other people who would suggest one thing or another.
Yeah, like you said, you know, there were some people that had some motivations to get rid of Jack, and I don't know. I think it's it's difficult to speculate, you know, wildly about it without getting a little too wild, you know, if that makes sense. But I don't know. His story is almost just too weird to think that it ended in such a, you know, such a mundane fashion, I guess. But
right.
You mentioned L.A., and I'm sure you're familiar with the term personality of place. But for anybody who's not, you know, it has to do with the given characteristics of physical locations, you know, sort of like the personification of place, too, perhaps. And L.A. and California in general has always had this eccentric personality. And in many ways, it's the perfect supporting actor in the story of Jack Parsons. There was a lot going on out there around this time period. You mentioned in the book that Albert Einstein attended a seance in California, which may strike some people as odd. You also mentioned that William Faulkner, one of the great modern novelists, found himself kind of stuck in L.A. writing scripts for B-movies later in his career. It's a topsy-turvy time here, as you called it. And as someone myself who's been to L.A. many times, I'm born and raised in Ohio, but L.A. has been essentially my second home. And as someone who's been there quite a bit, the energy out there, George, is markedly different than where I come from or any other place I've been. What is it about L.A. and California, you think, that made it then such an ideal companion for Jack Parsons in this story?
Yeah, no, it's a very good point. I mean, L.A. really is. There's a reason my book was called Strange Angel, and that's really because, you know, I see Jack Parsons as really, he couldn't have existed outside of the City of Angels, you know. I mean, he was really, you know, a strange Angelino. But that's kind of why the title was there, because it seems like ever since Europeans have arrived in America, and this is just looking at it from a kind of foreigner's perspective, I'm from England originally, but you look at all the myths, and California kind of is this font of myth, and it seems to have this strange kind of alchemical pull on people. You know, people say go west to find your fortune, or go west, you know, go west, go west. And I really wanted to delve into that. You know, people have moved to the state of California, into Los Angeles in particular, to kind of change their lives, to be transmogrified, you know. And it's there that, you know, everything, your old life can be transformed into gold. Like I say, alchemy, there's that very kind of pervasive sense of transformation in California. And, you know, a whole host of like modern archetypes have cropped up around this quality. You have the gold rush and the prospector panning for gold, which will change his life, make him rich. You know, you have the consumptive seeking out sunlight for their health. You know, they'll suddenly become a new person again, healthy again. You have the wannabe actor or actress kind of arriving in the city on a bus from the Midwest to become a star, you know. And I love that kind of aura of transformative possibility. And that's really like what Parsons kind of embodied. He just had everything about him, everything he wanted to do was infused with this idea of infinite possibility. He wanted to make rockets to go to the moon when nobody else said he could. Yeah, ridiculous, but in LA it could possibly happen. You know, he wanted to join, you know, to learn magic and to kind of rise up through the ranks of the occult practitioners until he rivaled the greatest magicians of all time. Everybody said impossible, but in LA, you know, it could happen. And so that was really hand in hand Parsons' story. I really wanted to kind of show Los Angeles as being really the only place that Parsons could have spawned from. You know, it was kind of like some kind of funky kind of crucible, a mixture of all these different ingredients of science, of mysticism, of movies, of modern myth, of past myth. And bubbling out of that was kind of Parsons himself.
Definitely, yeah. And you're speaking my language here, man, with the alchemy and the gold rush. And I wanted to ask you something about that. You know, maybe I'm reading too much into this, but, you know, with the large amount of people that relocated to California, like you said, to either search for gold or for better health, could that have had an alchemical or transmutative effect on the location itself?
Well, quite possibly. I mean, it's like the gold rush is the kind of metaphor made, you know, made real. Literally, like people digging up the earth, trying to find gold there. I mean, you know, you can definitely see in LA something which no place else really has. And I think, you know, I'm not, you know, I'm a skeptic at heart, but I do think there are certain places in the world, wherever they may be, Glastonbury, Tor, or Jerusalem, where strange things happen. You know, strange confluences of energies arise. And whether it's due to the gold, whether it's due to the promise of gold, perhaps more personally, I think it's definitely a place where things happen. And I think there are those places in the world.
Yeah, man. So let's talk a little bit about the state of science and rocket science in particular when Jack was growing up. You know, was this even a field at this point when Jack was a kid?
No, I mean, not at all. rocketry, like the term rocketry, the word rocketry didn't exist until I think 1931, 1932. So all of Jack's kind of youth when he was, you know, building little balsa wood rockets in his backyard or kind of messing around with gunpowder, he was kind of working in a vacuum, much like his rockets later would. But no, he was working kind of by himself. What there was were basically like a really thin network of people. And they were all people not much older than he was, like 16, 17. There were these little things, rocket societies, which were scattered around the world. There was one in England, there was one in Germany, there was one in New York. And basically these rocket societies were all inspired. The one inspiration they had was science fiction. There weren't textbooks on rocketry. There weren't, you know, lectures on rocketry. No universities had courses on rocketry. You know, nobody thought a rocket was actually in any way a kind of useful thing to study. The only people who'd studied rockets desperately were the science fiction writers of these pulp magazines, which Parsons and, you know, Wernher von Braun in Germany at the same time was reading the same magazines that Parsons was, because they kind of provided a kind of proving ground for rockets and for rocket science. And so basically kind of fueled by the science fiction that they were reading at the time, these little rocket societies scattered around the globe were kind of testing, just kind of, they'd get an old cocktail shaker. For instance, the New York Rocket Society, they built a rocket out of a cocktail shaker and like a kettle. And somehow they combined them, they filled it full of gunpowder, and then they'd set it off and they'd see what would happen, usually an explosion. And then they'd write about it and they'd send a letter off to the German Rocket Society and they'd say, we did this. And then the German Rocket Society would send a letter back. And, you know, Parsons kind of was desperately trying to be part of this. He kind of formed his own little rocket society with Ed Foreman and later Frank Molina. But that was it. It was all independent research. It was guys with dreams of going to the moon. No scientist treated them, you know, seriously at all.
You mentioned that the German Rocket Society, which was joined by Wernher von Braun, you know, that Parsons, and this is something that I didn't know before I read your book, but Parsons and I think it was Foreman actually had communicated with him via phone call, right?
Yeah, no, this was something I'd heard a rumor about, and I was very skeptical about. I thought, surely not, this couldn't happen. But, you know, at least three different people, either in, you know, their writings or Helen Parsons Smith herself, said that they had phoned up von Braun and spoken to him. I mean, I guess this would have been in the mid, late 20s. When they were teenagers, and apparently they did. They called up von Braun and they told them what rockets they'd been building. He told them what rockets he'd been building. I mean, they were all teenagers together, you know, joined by this love of rocketry. And yeah, they had spoken to him. They had corresponded with him. They had swapped designs. Eventually that communication stopped when the Nazis came to power and they started really looking into rocketry as being a, you know, something they should follow up. And von Braun was kind of swept away from the whole Rocket Society front. But yeah, back in the late 20s, that's what Parsons was doing. He was speaking to von Braun and, you know, swapping designs with him.
I thought it was funny, too, that you mentioned they had this correspondence, but then they sort of cut it off at some point because they didn't want to kind of share too many secrets with each other.
Yeah, exactly. It's funny when you kind of look into all these rocket societies and you look at their old letters and stuff, because everybody's like, yes, we're going to go to the moon together. But then it's also like, well, let's keep our secrets to ourselves to a certain extent. We want to get to the moon first. So it's this kind of, you know, friendly rivalry that's going on between these guys. I mean, I'm trying to think of like the closest thing you could get to like the rocket societies. And maybe it's like the early computer age, like in the 70s, when you had people like Steve Jobs, you know, kind of creating computers in their garage and, you know, kind of working by themselves, but also in rivalries against other computer manufacturers. Maybe that's the closest analogy you can get. But you know, even that's not quite the same, because by the 70s, most people realized computers were a big thing. But at the time Parsons was working, nobody thought rocketry was going to amount to anything.
Well, that secrecy kind of mimics magic, too, in a way, because, you know, you have, like, I, as a magician, you know, like, maybe I do want to share some secrets, but I think I want to keep the good stuff to myself, right?
Yeah, very much so. I mean, definitely. I think that's kind of really what attracted Parsons to, I mean, there are many similarities between rocket science and magic, bizarrely. When you look at them, you know, there's the whole kind of secrecy, you know, there's the whole element of building to a higher plane of existence, of, you know, transcending one's human condition. You know, there's also the fact that equations and ritualistic kind of magic both use kind of arcane symbols to kind of progress oneself. you know, there are kind of lots of analogies, which I think Parsons enjoyed that kind of correspondence between the two.
Yeah, and, you know, just to stick with rocket science here for a minute, I find some of the minute details of stories like this to be sometimes the most intriguing details. And there's one anecdote in your book that, as someone interested in creative writing, that really intrigued the shit out of me. And that was this nugget you dropped about Jack and Frank Molina writing a novel together about this, you know, fantastical world of rocketry. The novel was never published, wasn't even finished. But we do know what it was about because there was a summary of the story recovered by someone at some point. What was this novel about?
Yeah, it was a novel, but it was also, because of course this is an LA story, it was a film treatment. And what Frank Molina and Jack Parsons, who were the two kind of founding members of the Suicide Squad of Rocketeers, what they wanted to do was ultimately kind of write a story which they could then sell either to a publisher or, as it turned out, to a Hollywood studio, which would give them funding to build their rockets, because there was no funding in rocketry at the time. So they were literally trying to, you know, like anybody in LA, write a screenplay and get some money for it so they could kind of fund their own projects in rocketry. And it's a great story. It's great because it's so transparently a story about them. The story is about these young, heroic rocket scientists who are very well funded, you know, which is obviously like this wishful thinking they had, and how they're making rockets and how the world is, you know, paying attention to them. And there are dark forces out to try and steal their rocket plans. And the dark forces out to steal their rocket plans are, in fact, you know, the Nazis. So this was written in like 1936, 1937. So the story is all about these heroic scientists trying to kind of make a rocket to improve mankind's lot in the world, only for Nazis to try and steal the plans from them. And it's, you know, it's fantastic. And it's also incredibly prophetic, because not only, you know, did it turn out that the Nazis were interested in rockets, which at the time wasn't really well known. I don't think, you know, even the US government knew that they were really into rockets. But Parsons did, because, of course, he'd been speaking to von Braun. But not only is that interesting, but many of the characters in this kind of, I think, a roman au clef, is that right? A kind of, you know, based on true life story. What happened to these characters happened to the real life people. So you have the Frank Molina character. In real life, Frank Molina, he was, you know, a great rocket scientist. He was very interested in socialism. He was eventually hounded out of the United States for having gone to communist cell meetings before the war. And in this kind of story they wrote, it turns out that the Frank Molina character in that is also seen as, you know, being un-American and is forced to leave the country. But most surprisingly is the character based on Parsons, because there's a character who's very interested in the occult in this. And at one of the rocket tests in the story, this character rushes forward and attacks the rocket with like a wrench and blows himself up. And of course, not more than, you know, a little more than, what, 15 years later, Parsons would also be killed in an explosion. And so it's this very kind of idealistic story written by a couple of 20-something guys to try and raise money. Yet it also has these weird little prophetic hints of how their lives were going to turn out.
Yeah, that's a magical act in and of itself. I mean, really.
Very much so. Yeah. I mean, one, you know, the more I looked into Parsons' story, the more I kind of got these little shivers in my spine of just like, you can be as skeptical as you want, but after a while, all these things are going to start adding up, you know. after a while, there's going to be something that's undeniable here.
Yeah, and we should mention, too, that the pulp fiction, the sci-fi thread is really, it's a lesser discussed aspect of this story, but it's a really cool thread to unwind here or to pull on. And I'd like to do that, you know. And Jack grew up with an interest in these pulp magazines, these pulp fiction magazines, and it really is like what got him into, I guess, building his first rocket. So I think you mentioned that there was some build-your-own kits advertised in the backs of these pulp fiction magazines, and that's really what I think started him down the actual path of the construction of, you know, probably miniature skyrockets, obviously. But tell us a little bit about the interest and the impact that this pulp fiction had on Jack Parsons and then also the rest of his gang.
Yeah, no, I mean, I really wanted to show Parsons as like a hub between three worlds. One was science, one was the occult, one was science fiction. And I wanted to treat science fiction as kind of important as the other two in a way, because at the time, it really was. It was this great kind of forum of discussion of technology, really. And, you know, Parsons was a great fan of amazing stories and astounding science fiction, these kind of great pulp magazines in which you know, all these writers who became major names, like Ray Bradbury, like Robert Heinlein, L. Ron Hubbard himself, they all started as pulp writers for these magazines. And really, it was the only, these were the textbooks for the Rocketeers at the time. There was nothing else. There was just these stories. Many of the science fiction writers, by the way, were in fact, you know, science graduates, or, you know, had done PhDs in physics or something like that. So a lot of the science was pretty firm, you know, at least it was built on a scientific basis. And so for Parsons, this was great. It was like a textbook with a plot, you know, what could be better than that? And so he'd often follow the designs exactly as they were, you know, expressed in the story as best he could to kind of build his own rockets. And this was true of, you know, von Braun. This was true of Frank Molina. You know, both Parsons and Molina had read kind of Jules Verne's, you know, stories to begin with. And in fact, Jules Verne's From the Earth to the Moon is quoted again and again by rocket scientists throughout the ages. You know, I mean, from Jack Parsons' time onwards, as being like a moment when they wanted to become rocket scientists. It was a pivotal moment when people read that story. And so, yeah, science fiction for Parsons really was. It was like a gospel for him. It was very much his guiding light. It was what he returned to when he felt down building rockets that didn't succeed. He'd read another story and it would G him up again. And really, he would go and speak to various science fiction fans. He would correspond with science fiction fans. Science, you know, rocketry and science fiction were kind of the same thing at the time. So he was a member of, he became a member of the Los Angeles Science Fantasy Society, which Ray Bradbury was also a member of. And Ray Bradbury, who I spoke to a bit before he died, he remembered Parsons coming to speak to them and telling them of his rockets. And Bradbury thought this was incredible, that this guy was actually building the things he was writing about. And so it was great. It was this kind of imaginative spur for Parsons. It was, you know, it's also why he wasn't really taken seriously and why rocketry wasn't taken seriously, because the only people talking about it were kind of teenagers and 20-somethings, you know, thinking that, you know, they could get to the moon or to further galaxies. And most of the scientific establishment thought this was ridiculous.
Yeah. And, you know, at this point in the book, when you're talking about, like you mentioned, the Fantasy Society, the Los Angeles Science Fiction League, these groups, they're sort of like early private precursors to these big comic cons, you know, it's just people getting together talking about science fiction and the ideas and the stories. But it's in this same section that you were talking also about a local communist group that Parsons and the boys were kind of flirting with. A couple of them actually joined, Parsons didn't. And of course, this carried with it some controversy, so this was all very much on the down low. But it turns out the Science Fiction League also had to be kept pretty quiet because being a fan of sci-fi carried with it some of the same stigmas. And you actually wrote that Jack Williamson, a famous science fiction author, you wrote that he recalled that when he had undergone psychoanalysis in the 1930s, he had been warned that writing science fiction was symptomatic of profound neurosis. That's a pretty interesting assessment of science fiction writers and fans. So why was there such a stigma here?
Yeah, it's fascinating just to look back and considering what science fiction has become in the last, you know, 75 years, to look back and see how it was treated at that time. And it was really, I think it was partly because most scientists, you know, thought it was ridiculous. And the idea of even going into space, I mean, you know, in 1935, as late as 1936 or seven, you know, people still thought travel in space was impossible. I mean, many learned professors at Caltech thought it was impossible. That, you know, there had been one American rocket scientist kind of before Parsons who had worked by himself, Robert Goddard, and he had said, you know, back in the early 1920s, I think maybe 1918, 1919, that man might be able to fire a rocket to the moon. And he had been torn apart and had to go into exile in the desert. You know, that was how roughly people treated stories of traveling outside the world. You know, rocket science, rocketry was a kind of synonym for madness. And that's, you know, people just thought it was a lunatic idea. But it's something which, you know, Parsons didn't want to take on faith. He didn't want to take the opinion of all these people saying it was, you know, ridiculous. And, you know, it was the youth that basically turned it all around. Yeah, you know, science fiction was treated as something ridiculous by adults. But eventually those same teenagers who liked it would grow up and have, you know, be able to control things their way. So, you know, Parsons was attracted to groups, kind of outsider groups, I think, throughout his life. He liked the Science Fiction Society. He liked, you know, the OTO, the occult group he joined. He liked, you know, even the communist group to a certain extent that he was part of. I mean, back in the 30s, it wasn't too secretive to be a member of the Communist Party. I think, you know, people were experimenting with socialism, with communism. You know, the Cold War hadn't started yet. It was still seen as almost kind of like Parsons' own interest in the occult. People were like, oh, let's kind of flirt with communism for a bit. And so these were all kind of little outsider communities that eventually kind of grew. And, you know, in terms of communism itself, it grew into something more than a cult. But yeah, so these outsider societies, though, this is what Parsons kind of enjoyed being part of.
Yeah, and, you know, I find this funny, this just this secrecy of the Science Fiction League and whatever else. I mean, I find it funny because it was also around this time that newspapers begin to increase their coverage of rocketry and what Parsons and his crew were up to. You know, I think the Howard Hughes flight around the world was also making big news at the time. So it's a pretty interesting contrast to see the papers covering these, you know, previously fantastical science stories around the same time that a sci-fi club has to remain just as secret as a communist group. It just baffles me.
Yeah, well, you know, I think they had to stay secret because of scorn more than anything else. I mean, Parsons, as a young kid, was bullied because he would carry science fiction magazines under his arms. It was kind of like nerd culture before the nerds took over the earth. You know, it wasn't so much that it had to be kept secret because you'd be said you were insane. You kept it secret because it just, you know, you'd be bullied. People would joke at you. I think that's how it was really seen, you know, and that's why you'd keep it secret.
You mentioned that, you know, Jack's attracted to these outsider groups kind of throughout his life. And I think that's a good segue into, you know, his more religious and spiritual preferences. You know, he was impacted greatly by the text, The Golden Bough by Sir James George Frazer. What was it about this text that made such an impact on him?
Well, I guess, you know, The Golden Bough was, I guess, written in the late Victorian age. And it was, well, maybe the early 20th century. I don't have the exact date to hand, but it was the first kind of study, I guess, of comparative religion, of what we'd call that now. And basically what Frazer did was he showed that magic was, rather than just being a weird superstition that people followed, it was a cohesive system of thought. And, you know, magic basically, in Frazer's kind of view, became religion, and then religion became science. And he saw this kind of this journey of human thought, of human belief, traveling from magic to science. And for Parsons, of course, this was fantastic. This is what, you know, this is what he kind of believed very strongly, that magic and science were closely interlinked. I think, you know, Arthur C. Clarke has that great quote about any sufficiently advanced technology is indistinguishable from magic. You know, the idea that they're really the same thing. And that comes from The Golden Bough. And that's, I really think, what attracted Parsons to it. It was the idea that science, for all its white coats and slide rules and, you know, calculations, was really no different to what the alchemists were doing 500 years before.
Yeah, and I think we should also mention Jack gets into theosophy in or around 1939, when L.A. is becoming this hotbed for alternative religions, most of them with Eastern philosophies sort of embedded throughout them. Parsons wasn't quite sold on theosophy, but he did take to thelema. What was it about the work of Aleister Crowley and his thelemic religion that appealed so much to Jack Parsons?
Yeah, well, you're quite right. I mean, LA was flooded with all these different religions, you know, and different beliefs, spiritualism and Confucianism and theosophy. And, you know, Parsons did join, you know, did follow theosophy for a little bit. But what I think attracted him to Crowley was kind of just how, I guess, how dangerous it felt. I really think it was the danger that attracted him to it. I mean, he complains about theosophy in one of his letters, saying, I'm sick of hearing about the good and the true. You know, what I want is something that's kind of got a little danger to it. And I think Crowley offered that. And I think, you know, thelema offered that to him. You know, I mean, Crowley at the time, if he was known at all, was known as, you know, the wickedest man in the world. There was all this black magic kind of hyperbole tied to what he'd done. And suddenly in Britain, he was, you know, a regular tabloid kind of bugbear. But for Parsons, I think what Crowley kind of offered was a kind of way of looking at not just a kind of religious, Christian, proto-Christian kind of way of being a better self or whatever. Crowley was really talking about, I think, something dangerous, something on the edge, dealing with alien intelligences, working one's way up through secrets. it was a whole kind of Victorian mysticism, which I think appealed to Parsons more than many of the kind of more sunlight-driven cults, let's say, of LA at the time.
Yeah, we should probably go back in time a little bit to Jack's youth, because he has an interesting experience that you call his magical fiasco. I was wondering if you could tell us a little bit about that, and I guess if this was really his first, you know, sort of scientific or magical experiment.
Yeah, I mean, I think so. There's not much about it. It's really written by Parsons himself in his own writings. But he says that around the age of, I think, 11 or 12, he was in his room and he basically tried to summon the devil. And he writes that terrifying thing was he was successful. And he never wanted to do it again after that. That was it. He was done. But of course, he kind of did want to do it again. He eventually kind of went back to that. And I think, you know, I think lots of us around the age of 12, 13, you know, do we do that thing where we look in the mirror and we say Candyman or whatever. There are lots of, you know, you flirt with the occult at that age. It's very much, you know, play with a Ouija board. You do all sorts of things. But for Parsons, it definitely struck something real. He really thought he had kind of succeeded in some way. And it wasn't just like scaring oneself. He felt that he had touched something tangible on the other side of reality. And I think it went away for a while and kind of rocketry replaced it, science fiction replaced it. But then it came back kind of with reinforcements later in life when he found the OTO. And really, the OTO offered him a kind of laboratory for him to practice these tests of himself, of the supernatural world. You know, it gave him the guidebooks. Crowley's works were his science books, you know, for magic.
Yeah, and you also said in school that he preferred things like fencing and archery to the more traditional and popular sports, which makes sense, you know, considering his character. And also makes sense because there's an element, I think, of both science and magic in both of those. I don't know how you feel about that, but it does seem like they do have these very mechanical but also intuitive things to them or aspects to them.
Yeah, very much so. No, I think, I mean, noticeably compared to all other sports, they're kind of solo sports. You do individual sports, you know, you do them just yourself against an opponent in fencing or just you against the target in archery. But I think that appealed to him. He wasn't really ever a team player. But I think there's something mystical about them. There's something, you know, Parsons was a great romantic, and a romantic I mean by he believed in the romantic ideals of the 18th century. It was like the hero against the world. And that's how Parsons saw himself, as a man with a bow, as a man with a sword, you know, fighting off unbelievers, you know, left, right, and center, like going forward like a true hero. And yeah, there is something mystical about them. I think that appealed to him. It's very hard to kind of find out when he had this initial spur to kind of be this sort of character. But, you know, by the time he's 18, he's a fully paid up, self-made hero, or self kind of identifying himself as a hero.
Yeah, and I think it's important to point out, too, that, I guess you already pointed out that, you know, magic and rocketry are very similar to Jack. And really, I mean, they're just similar in general. It's not just a Jack Parsons opinion here. It's just that it's a famous example of a guy who's a scientist, also a practicing magician of sorts. And, you know, the way that he views it is, you know, both magic and rocketry had a basis in the imagination and in the scientific method, which is hard to deny when you really think about what magic is, you know, especially ritual magic, where you're going through a process like you would a science experiment.
So, very much so. You're absolutely right. I mean, that's, you know, I think to Parsons, they were really, you know, two sides of the same coin. They were just different ways of going about it. You know, it was physics compared to chemistry for him, you know, something like that. Rocketry and magic, they were both ways of transcending one's own place on Earth. They were both ways through abstruse equations or rituals of getting to another place. They were both kind of causational in a way. They both relied on a kind of a scientific method. Although, of course, some people wouldn't believe that magic does. For Parsons, he really believed it. He thought, if I do one thing, it will lead to another. And so he was kind of hyper-attuned to magic as a science.
It's worth noting, too, that he does join the OTO. He also has his rocket science pals, you know, the Suicide Squad. And those groups did sort of intermingle, but he and Ed Foreman actually did later on go into these occult experiments together. But it's funny the way that you described it in the book, that you related it from, I forget who said it actually, I think it was Ed's wife that you quoted, where she was like, you know, they worked on magic like they worked on science. They just went right to the heavy stuff. They didn't care about the beginning stuff. They just went right to the end, and they were tinkering with these magic spells, like with the most complex, difficult things at the end of the line there. I just thought that was really funny.
Yeah, no, it's kind of hilarious when you read about it, because the way he approaches magic is exactly the way he approaches science, which is all instinctual and skipping ahead to the... I think she says, yeah, they always skip to the end of the book. That's how they treated both rocketry and magic. They both wanted to be as extreme as quickly as possible. And, you know, for Parsons, the OTO really was, in a way, a kind of stepping stone to him creating his own kind of religion. You know, him combining aspects of, you know, voodoo and Victorian mysticism, his own brand of mysticism, Enochian magic, and so on and so forth, all kind of jammed together into this chaotic bundle. Just as rocketry was like him, you know, using parts of his imagination, using his knowledge of Greek fire, this ancient weapon, to kind of, you know, using that as the basis for one of his rocket fuel. It was all a kind of mishmash, which Parsons figured it had worked really well in his rocketry. So why couldn't it work just as well in his magic?
So, you know, let's talk about the final years of Jack's life. We mentioned his death. He dies at age 37. But before that, at age 30, you wrote that, quote, Parsons was cut adrift from the world of rocketry for the first time in his adult life. And that's a long story that we're not going to be able to tell in our time frame here, but it's worth reading about. But it was plain to see that Parsons was being left behind as the very science he had helped to create soared up and away from him. And George, that's evident in his career trajectory after that. He bounces around various companies, not doing anything nearly as important or satisfying as what he had been doing up to that point. He also falls in with some shadier characters, including L. Ron Hubbard here, and performs his famous Babylon Working at this time, which, for the listener, we summarized that in a previous episode, number 68, so for the sake of time, we don't have to go through all that right now, George. If you want to throw out a quick description of what that was, that's fine, but I am curious, you know, what you made of the Babylon Working the first time that you came across it, you know, the first time you read or heard about Jack going off into the desert to invoke the Red Goddess here, and then learning of the arrival of his Scarlet Woman, Marjorie Cameron, after that.
Right. Well, yeah, it was, you know, it was definitely eye-opening when I found, you know, a lot of his papers which describe the Working, and you read through it, and you're just like, oh, I see. He basically, up to this point, he had been doing really well at rocketry. Then the fact of his interest in the occult and various other things, his former friendship with communists, had made things very testy with the scientific world. And just as he was losing control of that, you could see him really clinging to his magic and really deciding to kind of double down on his magic. And the Babylon Working was ultimately, that was his rocket to the moon. That was his big chance to kind of create for himself a place in magical history, and not just magical history, history itself. I think he really thought this would change the world. So yeah, I was kind of amazed by how committed he was to this. You know, to begin with, he summons an elemental. He decides to summon an elemental which will replace his lost love. For people who haven't read the book, it's difficult to say this briefly, but basically Parsons became friendly with L. Ron Hubbard. L. Ron Hubbard kind of took away Parsons' girlfriend at the time and some of his money. Parsons was furious at this and decided to kind of replace his former girlfriend with an elemental he conjured. And he said he was successful, and he found who would become his second wife, Marjorie Cameron, the actress who we spoke about at the start of the show. He said was his elemental. He had summoned her. And with her, he conducted the Babylon Working, which was, you know, a variety of rituals, including sex magic. Although she didn't know what was going on, he was performing sex magic. He was, you know, doing rituals for kind of 2 months straight, I think, and all for the purpose of summoning the goddess Babylon into the world, bringing in a new age. Now, this was something that Crowley himself had thought he had done. And that kind of Parsons was kind of trying to surpass Crowley. He was really saying, no, your age is past. Now my age, the age of Babylon, the age of woman, the age of, you know, strength, strong women, to a certain extent, will come into this world and will transform it. And I was amazed by how deeply he went for this. I was amazed by how committed he was to this till the end of his life. You know, he didn't back down and say, oh, that was the Babylon Working was nothing. That was something I just, you know, got into at a bad time. He was committed to it till his death, you know, that Babylon had actually been conjured on the earth and was walking the earth. So he firmly believed he had ushered in the new age. And, you know, who's to say he didn't? But yeah, it was certainly an eye-opener when you read through the Babylon Working, you know, the writings of the Babylon Working, you see a man who has thrown himself into the role of like grand mage.
Definitely, yeah. And, you know, Marjorie Cameron, for what it's worth, is, I mean, she's worth an entire episode on her own. Yeah. She's a pretty fascinating character. But the end of Jack's life here, you know, I can't help but notice that, you know, in addition to the lack of fulfillment from his professional endeavors, these final years of his life are also characterized by what seems to me like a case of loneliness and maybe even depression. You know, he pretty much loses everything he ever worked for, professionally and personally. I guess he and Marjorie, you know, they go through some ups and downs, and they end up reconciling at the very end of his life after some time apart. But still, you know, it's hard not to feel sorry for him, isn't it?
Oh yeah, it's a real tragedy. He's like I said before, he was part of all these different societies of outsiders, and one by one, they were kind of all taken away from him, you know, and he was left alone. And, you know, while I think the magic had been a really great creative impulse for him up to a certain extent, it then became a kind of crutch and something he leaned on more and more and more. And it wasn't necessarily a healthy thing for him. You know, he started to do a lot more kind of extreme rituals. He started to really kind of throw himself into it without really a care of how it was affecting his own mental health. And, you know, he was lonely. He was alone, and all he had was his magic. And man cannot live on magic alone. You know, you need something more than that. You need something that is in the real world as well as in the magical world. And I think he increasingly became unmoored and kind of ended up, whereas before he could stare into space and he would see the stars and he would see the moon, which he longed to go to, you know, ultimately he ended up kind of staring into space and just seeing the void. And I think, you know, he was left just staring at the void. And that's, it's a tragic end to his life. You know, there are little hopes that he might have pulled himself back before his death. But, you know, towards the end of his life, it was really him staring out into space and not seeing much there.
Yeah, it is sort of a sad end to a really... Okay, so, you know, as crazy as his life has been, and as short-sighted as some of his decisions maybe seem to have been as well, he's still a brilliant man who helped create an entire industry, for better or worse. And it's just, it's hard not to acknowledge, I think, the heart that he had, you know? Just like, he just seemed to make these decisions with his heart. He always followed what felt right to him. And you can't really fault him for that on some level.
Well, you know, I mean, do what thou wilt. I mean, that was it. He followed yeah. his will. I mean, literally, even before he joined Crowley's society, I think that's partly why it was so interesting to him, because it allowed you to follow these paths which most other people thought were ridiculous. And so, yeah, I mean, you've got to give him credit for that. And you've got to give, you know, I mean, he really, I think, lived a thalamic life to a certain extent, as much as I understand that, in that he did follow, perhaps to a fault, his own will, right till the end of his days.
Yeah, he certainly did. So, you know, the TV show that's based on your book is on CBS All-Access right now. It debuted on June 14th. We're talking a week after the first episode debut, so I've only seen the first one. I mean, I'm sure you've seen the whole thing, right?
No, I'm afraid I haven't. I don't really have much skin in the TV game. I've seen the first two episodes, so I'm only one ahead of you.
Yeah, so it has a 10-week season, so it'll wrap up in mid-August, it looks like. So for people who are interested, you know, to watch it as these next few weeks unfold. And, you know, I know they've changed some things from the actual story, as they will do for TV and film. And I know this is a nonfiction story, so it's a bit different than adapting a novel. But what is it like for you to see your book, Strange Angel, on film?
You know, it's I wish I could be more fussy about it, but it's great. I mean, basically, you have to understand that Parsons and his story have been living in my head for kind of 16 years. So suddenly seeing him like spring to life on screen, you know, in such detail. I mean, that's the thing. It's so detailed. It's like freeing a prisoner from his cage, you know, and it's wonderful. You know, they have, you know, hundreds of people working on getting every single part of his life exactly as it was, you know, from the cigarettes he smoked to the car he drove. And I find that fascinating just because I spent so long trying to track down those details, and seeing them all on screen is great. I mean, I admit I have slightly mixed emotions in that, you know, I think, well, I'm delighted that Parsons' story is finally getting an airing on a big stage, because one of the main aims for writing the book was just to get his story out there so that he was acknowledged. Well, that's great. I also have this kind of like golem-like part of me that keeps muttering, you know, he's mine, he's all mine. So, you know, it's like when your favorite cult band is kind of discovered by the mainstream and you're like, no, but I was there before everybody else, I promised. But no, I think it's great. And yeah, there have been, you know, some characters have been condensed, some have been invented to move it forward. But I think the spirit of it all is really kind of in keeping with how I imagined it to be. So I'm pretty pleased with it at the moment. You know, we'll see what happens. I think, you know, the plan is for 5 seasons, each of 10 episodes each. So,
oh, wow.
Yeah. So the idea, if it goes that far, which I hope it does, but they can really go into depth on this. You can have, you know, whole episodes devoted to one ritual. You know, it would be, and they got some very interesting directors involved, you know, some kind of cult directors, you know, naturally. But, you know, directors like David Lowry, who did a great independent film called A Ghost Story, and Ben Wheatley, who's a great bizarre English filmmaker who does a lot of kind of weird psychedelic kind of crazy movies. So one, my hope is that, you know, they're setting up this basis as it is at the moment, a historical kind of, you know, fiction, a period drama at the moment, and then that'll be the basis for it just to go off in all sorts of different directions.
Yeah, and you know, this is a very different kind of story to tell under the CBS banner, I guess. It just strikes me as, I mean, we're living in such an interesting and fascinating time that I can pull up a CBS show. Granted, it's not on their network television, it's on their streaming service, but I can pull up a show that CBS has put money behind about Jack Parsons, where it's about rocket science, sex magic, I'm here and Do What Thou Wilt, and Aleister Crowley's, you know, teachings are on fucking TV. It's so weird to me. And to be honest, like, I haven't really been in this scene for very long. Just a few years now, I've really just been learning about this stuff. And even then, it's just so weird. I never would have expected to see this story on film. What do you make of it actually making its way mainstream?
Yeah, well, you know, we're living in weird times, aren't we? I mean, everything seems to be slightly kind of askew. So maybe it's just perfect time for Parsons to arrive. I mean, you know, I'm glad. I hope he would have approved. I think he would have approved. I think Crowley would have. He'd have loved the publicity. But I think it's great. I mean, in a way, I kind of think we're going through a period which is rather similar to like cinema in the 70s, when everybody's trying lots of weird stuff. And it may all fall on its face, you know, in the next 5 years. Hopefully not before like the whole, you know, series has played out. But I think it's, you know, people are realizing they've got to take risks. They've got to, you know, tell slightly odd stories out there. And Parsons is definitely an odd story, but it's also, you know, it is an odd story. There's sex magic, there's rocketry, but it's, you know, it's a story I really think people should know more about. We should know that behind all these sciences that we take for granted, that behind the jet propulsion laboratory, which seems a very staid kind of, you know, space exploration, institution, are these weird figures, you know, like Parsons, who founded it all. I think it's too easy to get swept up, you know, to believe that everybody is normal. Parsons is a great idea for, you know, he's proof that try and be not normal, and that can help. You know, do different things, follow your path, do what thou wilt. I think it's good. I'm very positive. I'm for it. Slightly puzzled, but definitely for it.
Yeah, I mean, Parsons' story is really one, as we've alluded to kind of throughout this. It's meant for film. It's just meant to be seen. You know, it's as great as your book is, as great as the Sex and Rockets book is. It's just like, you know, like we talked about film noir and this sort of pulpy feel to it, the sci-fi feel. Like, this is meant to be seen in this treatment. So I'm glad it's getting it. Last question for you, George. What do you think viewers who are unaware of the Parsons story will take from this show or make of it? Because I can imagine a lot of them may be a little bit shocked or surprised by it.
Yeah, I'm what I'm really hoping for, I'm kind of jealous of people who don't know the story yet, because I'm hoping that they're watching the show and they're like, oh, it's about a rocket scientist, you know, and as I was when I first read that first footnote, yeah, it's a rocket scientist who has strange beliefs. And then they'll turn it on and they'll watch it and they'll just be like, oh, I didn't think that'd be this strange, you know. I didn't think it would take this path. And I think the thing is, you know, Parsons' story continually bamboozles, you know, down through the years, even though he only lived to the age of 37, like every year something extraordinary happen. You know, something, some weird thing would happen. And just as long as people get pulled into that, they realize, first of all, it's true. And second of all, that, you know, I know this actually happened. This is a great thing. I hope people get swept away by the story.
Yeah, I actually told my parents about this story, which, you know, they knew nothing of it. And I intrigued them with the description of it. So, you know, I'm curious to see if they follow through on watching the show and then what they would make of it. Because they're, you know, they're very typical Midwestern U.S. people. They don't know anything about the occult or magic or even rocket science, for that matter. So right. It'd be an interesting sort of conversation to have with somebody like that to see what they really thought of this story, especially seeing it, you know, for the first time and not actually reading about it. So
I think it's, you know, we're kind of used to historical dramas of, say, scientific minds, you know, like A Beautiful Mind, say, a classic kind of story about a scientist who has, you know, a troubled personal life or something like that. And we're used to kind of the beats that takes. But I think Parsons' story just takes so many different beats off the track that people will begin watching it thinking they're seeing one story. And by the end of it, they'll just be like, what just happened there? when did we end up, you know, in a sex magic ritual with L. Ron Hubbard, you know? So, I'm very curious to see what the response will be too.
Definitely, man. Well, before we go here, tell people where they can find the book if they want to read it and find more of your work if they're interested as well.
Yeah, well, the book is still available on Amazon.com or at your local bookstore if you order it. Strange Angel, The Otherworldly Life of Rocket Scientist John Whiteside Parsons. So yeah, go to Amazon or you can catch a TV show at CBS All-Access and you can get the rest of my work at my website, which is just georgependle.com. So yeah, have fun.
Awesome, man. Well, hey, thanks so much for being here. I really do appreciate your time. Take care of yourself, and I'll talk to you soon.
Been a pleasure talking to you. I really enjoyed it.
Absolutely, man. And I think there's only one way, George, that we can end this. So I say to you, ad astra.
Paraspera.
And there you have it. My thanks again to George Pendle. He's a busy man, so I am extremely grateful and a bit humbled to get an hour of his time. My hope was to fill in some of the other details that were part of the Parsons story that were not touched on back in episode 68, as well as get George's personal impression of what it was like writing and researching him. And I think we did a hell of a job of that in the time that we had. California's personality of place, Pulp Fiction, and the preeminent rocket scientist of all time. Some of my all-time favorite things to rap about. You know what I realized after recording this, though? The world we live in now is pretty fucking boring. Especially compared to the world Parsons lived in. I mean, if you're familiar with those pulp stories Parsons grew up on, they were full of such hope and optimism. Science was thought to be the great savior of humanity, its future, its destiny. So idealistic, so cool. And indeed, mostly fiction then. A pipe dream, most of it. But you have guys like Parsons who wanted to actualize it, and did. And look at science and technology now. It creates any damn thing we want. But it's zapped our hope and terminated our optimism. There's nothing left to fantasize about. And that could be why you see ideas and movements like transhumanism permeating the public consciousness. It may not necessarily be some evil, nefarious plot. Could just be a cure for boredom. Just another science experiment dreamt up by folks who have nothing left to dream about. And that's why I enjoy Jack Parsons and his story so much. It's a great character study set amidst a socio-cultural backdrop that's slowly shifting and is unlike anything we'll ever experience. You can get a small taste and feel for it when you visit LA or pick up an old pulp magazine. You can feel a fraction of the energy from that time and place when you read about it in Strange Angel, or watch it now, I guess. And as someone sensitive to these sorts of energetic feels, it absolutely does make me more hopeful when I feel it, more creative, more fantastic, and it motivates me to keep moving forward, just as it motivated Jack Parsons. In fact, I've talked privately with some people recently and alluded to this in the last episode as well, that I've had so much creative energy flowing through me the last month or so, which has fostered new ideas and renewed a sense of optimism for me. And at the risk of not being too dramatic about it, I think it coincided with rereading Strange Angel and this chat here with George. So if you're looking for something similar in your life, maybe try immersing yourself in a time and place that's called to you and given you that sort of feeling before. No Patreon extension here, but I do have to give a quick shout out to Jerry Cthulhu, who some of you may know as one of the hosts of the Nox Menti podcast. Jerry became our newest patron just in the last couple days, and if you want to join him on the esoteric endeavor, point your browser to patreon.com/occulture and choose from one of four levels of support and rewards, and help me continue to perform this magical working of mine. And how about two shows this week to start what's been a hot, hot, hot July? And as I look at what's coming up, it's only going to get hotter here in the Kingdom of Ohio. So let's take a few days to cool ourselves down, and then we will heat this flask back to boiling and continue on the path of personal transformation. Until then, though, you've just been initiated into OCCULTURE. I am Ryan Peverly, reminding you to love yourself, think for yourself, and question authority.
This cassette.